This is Duke University.
Well, welcome everyone this afternoon. It's a beautiful afternoon. It's not quite as warm as it was yesterday, but it's still a lovely afternoon. And we appreciate your coming in from the outside where the sunshine is for a little bit of, we hope, intellectual stimulation here. Not that you can't get intellectual stimulation on the outside, but there's a lot of it gathered in this room. So welcome. It's an honor for us to have Carol Larson here. She has been here before to speak to our group, but not for, I think, 13 years.
10. No, it 10 11, years? Yeah, 2006.
2006. Yeah. So that's 13 years. Isn't it 17 now?
Yeah. It depends on when you start counting.
In any event, it's great to have
it's
you
great
back.
To see you. It's great to be here.
Great to have you back.
It's great to be here.
Carol has been the head of the Packard Foundation. She was the vice president for programs there for a number of years before she became the president of the foundation. And she's been the president of the foundation for, I think, something like, 12
13.
Years? 13 years. Packard Foundation is a very interesting foundation from a number of points of view. It is a family foundation, still very dominantly influenced by the family, but with a board of non-family, including non-family members. And it has had a reputation of really doing fascinating things. For example, the thing that I remember and think very well of, the major initiative that the Packard Foundation and the Hewlett Foundation took in creating Climate Works, large organization focusing on climate. Carol told me that it was jointly sponsored by Hewlett and Packard, each of which committed initially, I think, $500 million for over 7 years, I think, seven years. Yeah. And that's subsequently been renewed. So the initial gift of creating it was that $1 billion plus some other foundations came in. But the organization now has sharpened its focus and organizational structure so that at this point, Carol told me just now, that there are enough other foundations that have come in that they've aggregated giving now up to $500 million a year in terms of, so a great example of what can happen when you bring foundations together that work together in a collaborative fashion. And Lord knows to solve the climate works problem, the global warming problem, it needs a lot of collaboration to get the problem solved. In any event, the Packard Foundation is been doing all sorts of interesting things. When Carol was here the last time, she laid out the program that Packard had initiated, I think in partnership with some of the California state government school boards, et cetera, to ensure that every child in California have access, every child in California at the age of four have access to preschool, basically. And she told me this afternoon that at this point, they researched that effort from the beginning very carefully, studying impact projections, getting a team of social scientists to look at it from the very beginning, the way in which really good strategic philanthropy is supposed to be done. And she said that at this point, it appears that most 85% of all of the eligible children, the four-year-olds in California, do have access to preschool. I think originally the hope was 3 and 4 years, mm-hmm. Right?
3 and 4 year olds.
And 4 year olds, but it finally focused on 4 years, and that's a pretty good achievement. And they've been at it now for, at this point, 15 years. Yeah. It also had the most interesting diagram, basically a logic model.
Our logic model.
The logic model was up on the Packard website, and it was covered so many pages at the same time, it was very hard to get it up on one page. But in any event, I've never seen a foundation that had the guts to try to do something like that, and they did. So Carol is a pioneer in the foundation world, not only in her running of the Packard Foundation and in collaborating with foundations in California and elsewhere, but also in the foundation sector. She's been the chairman of the board of the Council on Foundations, and highly regarded in that role. She's been influential in strengthening that organization and the other organizations that Packard has supported, like the Center for Effective Philanthropy in the country, that are playing major roles, and the Grant Makers for Effective Organization. Many of you know about philanthropy. Grant Makers for Effective Organization is a group of foundation officers and others who are committed to the importance of strengthening the infrastructure of nonprofit organizations. And the Grantmakers for Effective Organization was really founded by the Packard Foundation. Barbara Kibbe, who was their program officer, running basically what started as infrastructure training for grantees of the foundation. They said, this is something that all foundations need, not just our grantees. And so they expanded it. And it is, I think, the fastest growing of all the infrastructure organizations around. So it's a legend of pioneering there. And Carol is the source of the ideas that created that legend, I guess, and also David and Lucille Packard.
Yes, for sure.
But in any event, it's great pleasure to honor you, have you here with us. You honor us by your presence. I'd like to welcome Carol Larson, President and CEO of the Packard Foundation.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Well, it really is my great pleasure to be here. It has been since 2006, and I don't know what month it was, but it's wonderful to be here. But, you know, I've so benefited over the years from talking with Joel. I mean, talk about a pioneer or someone who has transformed the field through his books, through his generosity of spirit, his kind of reinforcement of the wonderful charitable giving impulse of people in the country and making it better. Can you hear me now? Yeah, just let me know and say. So I just have benefited so much from knowing Joel, and I really look forward to his new book coming out very soon.
They don't even know about it.
Oh, really?
Except a few. Yeah. I've kept it a secret. I want it to be a big surprise.
Okay, seriously? Okay, all right. Well, he has a new book coming out. I won't tell you what it's about. I won't tell you what it's about. So, as Joel said, last time I was here, it was 2 years into becoming president. It was about 4 years after, or 4 to 5 years after Paul Brest had become president of the Hewlett Foundation and had really started to change the field about writing about strategic philanthropy. And so I think that he and the Hewlett Foundation's work on this had so much impact for the better on how we do our grant making at Packard and in the field generally. And so I did talk about our statewide work on preschool. And as Joel mentioned, we also do a lot of work on climate change and on ocean health. The Packard family built the Monterey Bay Aquarium, but we also fund deep ocean research. We have a science fellowship program. But today I'm talking about something that may seem a little parochial, and that's what's happening in our own backyard at Packard. What's happening in the Silicon Valley? And it really is on my mind about how we as a foundation can do better. And I wonder if you'll have ideas for us, and also if it has relevance to what you may be facing here in North Carolina and in the Research Triangle. So today what I thought I would do is, let me see if I got this.
Got
is you know, give you a little bit about the background of our foundation and sort of, and then why we chose to fund this Giving Code report, which is online. We don't have hard copies of it, but it's online and you could check it out in full detail. And then what it showed, you know, about tremendous growth economically in the Silicon Valley and also growth in philanthropy, but also that context of such huge and growing community challenges, and potentially the apparent disconnect between the two. And then what are the opportunities for foundations like ours, or for people with donor-advised funds, or community foundations, or corporate foundations? How can we do a better job of closing this gap? So first, I just would, as Joel mentioned, our founders were Dave and Lucile Packard. It's their private family money. We established in 1964 around their dining room table. William and Flora Hewlett, obviously, were good friends. The couples shared the same house with the famous garage where Dave and Bill worked and created, used the oven, I think, to bake something in the early days of HP. And then both families put the bulk of their wealth in private foundations. And the Packards and the Hewletts, though, are different. Hewlett just celebrated its 50th, but they're different in that the Packards chose to continue it as a family-controlled foundation, and the Hewletts didn't after Bill died. they change. So for us, we have a special membership. Our bylaws are on our website. Special membership that keeps the family in control. But the day-to-day governing board is half family and half general trustees. And of the family right now, we have three from the second generation, the daughters of Dave and Lucille, and five from the next gen. So as much as my tenure as president has been about preschool and oceans and reproductive rights and climate, it has been a lot about that transition of holding the best of family philanthropy with a professionally staffed foundation, embracing the family's interest while also having a governing board that is a equal decision-making and input. So we can talk more about that. But our foundation, very similar to the Hewlett family, by the way, have focused for the whole 50 years in some key areas. The specific strategies have changed over time, but a lot of focusing on children, and particularly young children, in addition to our long-term strategic initiatives around things like preschool. The family built the Packard Children's Hospital at Stanford, and so they get some significant support from us. Enabling the creative pursuit of science, it's probably about $80 million a year we do on basic science. Dave really believed that basic science was what led to incredible discoveries for the improvement of the world. Slowing population growth and advancing reproductive health and rights definitely has been a core focus of Dave and Lucille in 1964 and all the way through to today, particularly around reproductive rights, access to contraceptives, access to safe and legal abortion, and conserving and restoring Earth's natural systems. And I would say of our budget, that is getting the bulk of it right now around climate change and ocean health. So in 2016, we awarded $307 million in grants, and actually our payout was about the same. I am excluding there, though, a special grant we made. We do it every 5 to 10 years of that core capital support for the Children's Hospital, which was an additional award of $100 million. That's what the little asterisk is. It'll be paid out over a number of years. But you notice that over these years, since 1964, we've become quite global. So half of the dollar going out are going to benefit, or 42% people living in other countries, and 58% for the U.S. One of the things I've loved, first of all, I've loved my job, and I get to meet people like Joel. I get to meet all of you. But I also have such deep respect for the family and its set of values and its orientation toward the nonprofit sector. And so all the way through, while the foundation grew, and we're about $7 billion in assets now, no matter how global we get, they really believed in their heart that every philanthropist should care about their local community as well, that you should never work right in your backyard. So Dave, even when he was CEO of HP, sat on the school board. I don't know if it was late in the days of HP, but it was. But he was very involved civically. And then Lucille, that was, her daughters talk about how they thought their mom had a full-time job because they sat in a lot of parking lots while she was at board meetings at local nonprofits. So it was kind of in the DNA. And in my tenure as president, our board, both general trustees and our family members have always said, Carol, okay, we're working in 20 different countries, we're doing climate change, we're doing policy work, what are we doing locally? And so we've had a dedicated local program that focuses on 5 counties in the peninsula. And 2 of those counties, San Mateo and Santa Clara, are what people refer to as Silicon Valley. In those 2 counties, 2.6 million people live. It's about 1,700 square miles. The other counties in the beige, it's sort of hard, are San Benito, Monterey, and Santa Cruz. And we chose those counties in large part in the early days because a lot of the employees of HP lived there. And especially San Benito, as commute and affordability got worse. So, but our focus, we can't do all of California, we can't do all of the Bay Area, but we focus on those 5 counties. And about each year we support about 200 organizations with general support or capacity building grants. But the foundation, again, even though we stayed global, we definitely wanted to keep that footprint in the local area. So why did we commission this report called the, which eventually was titled The Giving Code?
That's the garage.
That's the famous garage. It's now owned by HP. And it's, you can go visit it. It's a museum. And but you know, as our grant, as our program officers were out in the community in that local grant making program, they were hearing so many stories of distress and dissatisfaction from the leaders of local nonprofit organizations, that they saw all this wealth around them, and why wasn't it coming toward them? Why were they facing increased demand, et cetera, and they weren't attracting the attention, at least in their point of view, of the right proportion of new philanthropists. And similarly, in talking to new philanthropists, whether it be about our global climate work or others, you know, definitely a skepticism we were hearing through our program officers and our own contacts about the efficiency and the effectiveness of the local nonprofit sector and the attractiveness of it, you know, especially given that, you know, some of the global work, you can get a lot more ROI from some of your dollars invested. So we thought, well, let's try to inform this a little bit by data. And so even though, so we retained Open Impact, there are two consultants, Alexa Caldwell and Heather McLeod Grant. And they really were going to try to take a more comprehensive look. It's not a perfect look, but a more comprehensive look about what is the charitable giving that originates in Silicon Valley, how has it been growing, where has it been going, and what's the experience of our local community-based organizations in relationship to that. So they really put together a lot of different data sources, getting the quantitative numbers from the local private foundations, but also their surveys and data collected by the Nonprofit Finance Fund and the Foundation Center. And then they did their own survey of community-based organizations in Silicon Valley, those two counties, San Mateo and Santa Clara. And there were about 130 community-based organizations that responded to the survey. And those, they defined community-based organizations as nonprofits in those two counties that pretty much 100% or 90%+ of their work is dedicated toward people in those counties. So excluded from that would be Stanford, which is a global institution, but community-based, that's how they were using it. So they did a pretty good survey of community-based organizations. And then, unprecedented to our knowledge, was that Schwab and Fidelity opened up their data sources about donor-advised funds that originated really? With donors in Silicon Valley, right? So based in those two counties. And then, over a year, they held lots of conversations and focus groups together with high net worth individuals, with nonprofit leaders, both in private foundations and also community foundations and corporate foundation. So again, it's the most holistic approach that I've seen in terms of looking at philanthropy in a particular area. And it's causing what we hoped, which is a lot of dialogue and conversation. So my question to all of you, and we'll have plenty of time, I'm sure, to discuss, is it relevant to you? You know, do you have a similar snapshot of what's happening in North Carolina or in the research triangle? Do you see some of the same tensions between the local need and where the new money is going? So someone at our foundation just put a few things about you here. You know, number 5 hotspots for tech boom. Number 4 is a startup hub. And yet, you know, the real housing crunch, I guess, already. But you could fill it in a lot more. So let me turn to that. That's why we did the study. We hope it's relevant to others. We know it's going to be relevant to us in thinking about how we can be better. But let me focus on the growth piece in Silicon Valley. And so, you know, it's the stories you read about. We've come a long way from that garage. But it keeps innovating and innovating and innovating and having incredible economic contributors through entrepreneurs. So in 2016, there were 21 unicorns, for those of you who do investment or don't. That's where a company is going to go public and is valued at over $1 billion before the IPO. just looking at sales from publicly traded tech companies, I think it was from 2015, it was $833 billion in revenue. There are 76,000 millionaires or billionaires in those two counties. And back in 2012, when Facebook had its initial public offering, in one day they created 900 new millionaires. And these people are young. You know, they're going to be with us for a long time, fortunately, and are just an incredible story of accumulated wealth and potential for doing real good with that. The Zuckerbergs, of course, made the big announcement with, and their wealth, I guess, is valued, although I just saw something in the New York Times, it's more like $51 billion, not $56 billion. But anyway, needless to say, the California global economic, California's global economy is driven a lot by Silicon Valley, but it's a big engine for our whole country. So the authors of this report then tried to accumulate where is the giving going for individual giving, private foundations, corporate giving, and donor-advised funds. And the big news here is it's wonderful. It's huge growth. So just to run through a little bit of it, and again, the report is online. They looked at the IRS data, so this is only for itemized tax filers, people who itemize their charitable giving. And so in this period of time, from 2008 to 2013, residents of those two counties in Silicon Valley reached up to 3.7% of their adjusted growth income as listed as being going to charitable causes. And of course, you can see that far outpaces that percentage for the United States overall or for California. So people, at least from what they're putting on their tax returns, are really stepping up in terms of charitable giving. In addition, over this time, we have a lot of private foundations that were created. The green represents new foundations that were over 10 million at their time of first being established. And so it doubled, I guess if you added up all the greens before and after that line, it's doubled in numbers since 2000 in terms of numbers of foundations that are over 10 million in assets. Self-reported corporate support, including from foundations, but also their corporations themselves, also really grew from 47 million to 117 million. Our local business journal puts this out, and my understanding is it's self-reported, and it doesn't just include their private foundation or their corporate foundations, but general corporate philanthropy. And then also the big thing that I'm learning a lot more about and wondering a lot more about is the growth in donor advised funds. So this is just information from Schwab and Fidelity that they provided for this study. And it shows that the number of donor advised funds between those two, established by people living in those two counties, is up to 4,524 donor advised funds, with an average value of $490,000 in the donor advised fund. But overall, collectively, $2.2 billion sitting in those donor advised funds. Meanwhile, our community foundation, which wasn't shown on that, have you had Emmett Carson come and talk to you?
No, I've invited him for next year.
Yeah, that's good. So he's shaking up the community foundation world. And his approach was, hey, people in Silicon Valley don't live only locally, they live globally. And our community foundation should go with where their definition of community is. And we should be a place for them to set up donor advised funds and to give globally, statewide, locally. And he's really done a lot. You can see in terms of the growth in assets that they have under management went from the $1.7 billion in 2007 all the way up to $7.3 billion today.
Yep. Wendy?
Emmett, Carson. And Carson, Carson.
And I should note that I think that this is so far out of, there's no other community foundation that I know of in the country that would have probably as much as $2 billion in assets. So you can see that the difference between $7.3 billion and $2 billion.
Yep.
I think New York is probably the largest.
And his donors actually are coming from all over, and their money is going to many different places, which I'll give to. Whereas a lot of the community foundation models have been to support your local community in terms of where the money goes to. They just are having their 10th anniversary. Basically, we and several other foundations supported the merger of what had been two separate community foundations, one in San Mateo County and one in Santa Clara County. We helped them work with McKinsey to bring their foundations together. They hired Emmett as the CEO and pretty much changed their business model in some ways, or grew it, expanded on it, and then experienced this growth. So, you know, all of that is really good news, right? That increase in donor advised funds, people getting the charitable deduction, setting it aside for charity, the creation of private foundations, the increase in corporate giving, you know, I want to applaud that. You know, that's just huge. And our foundation we have an endowment, and so we don't take a position on donor advised funds, but I think it was Fidelity who reported for theirs. That I think it was 37% in the year 2016 or 2015, 37% of the dollars that were held in their donor advised funds went out that door. You know, people are talking about mandatory payout for donor advised funds. So how that translates into others and which one, but in the aggregate, there's a considerable amount of payout that goes out each year from those.
The average figure is 23%.
Okay, well, that's
23% of all the assets go out. It went out in the last year.
Yeah. So we think we're aggressive at Packard because we do 5.35% when the requirement is 5%, and we are aggressive. It has real impact on your purchasing power down the line. Okay, so meanwhile, though, let's shift to the challenges, you know, of the Silicon Valley and of Santa Clara and San Mateo. And, you know, it's a story for our country. And I know you had Larry Kramer here who talked about polarization in our democracy, but there's obviously a lot written about the inequality, the growing inequality of opportunity in our democracy. You know, anyone who cares about kids, you know, should read Our Kids, Bob Putnam's new book, and I had a chance to interview him. Or if you just look at what happens to young children and you look at that bottom quintile, those young children often in communities of color, often baked in areas of persistent poverty, the opportunity gap is growing, not shrinking, over time. But certainly in terms of just the economic impact in this period of great growth in Silicon Valley is hitting families very differently. And so right now, according to this survey they did a bunch, and just collection of data recently there, 30% of the residents in Santa Clara and San Mateo County say they rely on either public or private assistance. So whether it be WIC or SNAP or just going to your local food bank that might be privately run, to get some sort of assistance to meet their daily needs. 17% earn less than $35,000 a year. Middle class is declining. Low-income families earn less than they did in 1989 when you factor in the inflation. So as the authors of the report say, it seems like the population in these two counties is going in one of two directions, either getting a lot wealthier or getting a lot poorer. One of the biggest indicators is housing. It's crazy. So all these new millionaires and others investing in the area is great news in many ways for philanthropy, but it's also creating huge problem for people living in the area in terms of housing. As you can see, rent is 227% higher than national average. The one that really got me was last week. It was either the San Jose Mercury or the San Francisco Chronicle talked about you know, how housing and homelessness was really impacting school districts. And a school district that's about 10 miles from where I live in Palo Alto, so the East Palo Alto School District, Ravenswood School District it's called, they serve 3,000 students, and fully 30% of their students are now homeless, living in cars or vans or moving out. Now, this is a highly immigrant community, African American and legal and Latino community, but it's a real, real challenge. It happens to be the school district where Chan Zuckerberg have announced their new primary school. Priscilla Chan is trying to create one there. But everyone is struggling with this about how are the kids going to learn when their families are really having to double and triple and quadruple up or live in cars or move away. And the housing crisis and what it takes to solve it is obviously much bigger than philanthropy will ever be, but it's definitely having an impact for our area. So this has an impact on the nonprofit organizations in our area, and they're already feeling it. And so that survey I talked about that the authors of this report did, you know, found that of the community-based organizations, 80% report increased demand, 54% had a waiting list for services, and of the group that responded to the survey, there were 60% of them specifically served non-white populations. And I'll talk a little bit more about the growth a little bit later in numbers. So demand for services. In addition, you can imagine that it just as employers, they're experiencing difficulty. They're having trouble finding rent, paying rent for their own nonprofit offices. You know, a lot of them are getting kicked out or forced out. The need for space that's affordable for nonprofits is really exacerbated. Housing for its employees is a real problem. They pay nonprofit salaries, and how can you afford that or live anywhere near it? And that's making it more difficult for people to acquire talent. And then I don't think this is just because of the what we're going through now in terms of this incredible economic boom and the pressures that it's putting on low-income communities, but I don't think it's just for that, it's exacerbated, but these same nonprofits are saying that right now 30% of them are running deficits annually. 40%, you know, close to half had less than 3 months in reserves, and over half had carried a deficit for at least one of the last 5 years. So, you know, on the one hand, you're seeing the 73,000 millionaires and billionaires, the growth in donor-advised funds, the increase in giving by corporations and creation of private foundations, and then you're seeing this real increase in demand, more financial difficulty in keeping civil society going, nonprofits going in Silicon Valley. This slide is a little bit hard to read, but the author's point of view is just that when you look at the bottom part of the slide, at organizations that have less than $1 million in revenue, you know, it's really different than the higher education and the hospitals. I mean, I just said Packard Children's Hospital, right? We made a $100 million award to them. But definitely you have huge nonprofit institutions that attract a lot of revenue, whereas the human services and the arts, culture, religion, environment, et cetera, are much smaller. And in fact, there are 9,725 nonprofits in those two counties, and 77% of them have less than $1 million in revenue. So we'll get to sort of what does that mean if you're a nonprofit executive, but it's pretty stark in terms of the difference between some of the larger institutions that are part of the nonprofit sector and then those community-based organizations that we were talking about. So now let's look at what do we know about where the money is going? You know, the charitable impulse, where is it going? This slide does not present all dollars. It's mostly there to show the difference between money that's going outside of the two counties and money that's supporting community-based organizations in those two counties. What's missing from that is giving, say, to Stanford or others, because it's neither going outside, but it also isn't what you would call this community-based organization. It's a nonprofit. So we need to create more slides. But just to show the difference here, you know, of private foundations that they included in this study, which would include ours, $1.2 billion in 2015 went outside of the region, and $45 million went to community-based organizations in the region. Of the donor advised fund money that Schwab and Fidelity reported, you know, $341 million went outside of the region and $61 million here. And of corporation money of $54 million in cash outside of the region and four. And you can imagine, I mean, there were such captains of industry like Dave and Bill who really cared about their local community. HP, Cisco, a whole bunch of really important pillars of the community emphasize local philanthropy, but those companies have changed too. And they're more globally focused, and their employees are more. And so whether it's corporate philanthropy for their employees or just in terms of the interests and of their customer base, they do more global philanthropy. So what, you know, the big question is then why, okay, what should a foundation like ours, that's always cared about the local community, has this in the DNA, yet is global in its scope, how can we help address this gap? How should we improve? So I'm looking forward to your ideas. The authors went out and they interviewed all kinds of the new donors, high net worth individuals. These were perceptions. These aren't reality. But you know, the perceptions about the kind of philanthropy that they wanted to do versus what they viewed as the old school philanthropy. So, you know, these would all be familiar terms for you, you know, about we want to be about impact or we want to be about disruption. We want to use multiple channels in our giving. We want to include working with business and high tech and networks. It's perceptions, and I think even the authors say that it's of limited use now as a chart, but they heard a lot of kind of skepticism and distinguishing between what people perceive to be the value of nonprofits and the kind of philanthropy that they wanted to do. So now the authors talk about it more in four buckets of the newest philanthropists want to be about innovation. They want to start, you know, take a new approach. Is Michael Fay here? Anyway, but anyway, I know you just had this seminar this morning. You hear from great, great people, great social entrepreneurs about taking new approaches to giving. You want to have high impact, you know, that whole return on investment. How can you invest $1 and get many more dollars in return? And it's just more expensive to support organizations in the Silicon Valley than it is to get high impact in Addis, Ethiopia. You want to have more connection. You want to get in there and change it and involve with it than to just be of support. You know, one of the things that the Packard family members always like to say, one of our third values is belief in individual leadership. So our values are integrity, respect for people, which we train program officers around. You don't walk into a room with a sense of arrogance and having the answers. You walk in with an openness to listening and learning. Belief in individual leadership. You really do listen to that nonprofit leader and you trust them and you don't say yes to everyone, but then you kind of get out of their way. And so in terms of going in and wanting to change how an organization is run or scale or whatever, I know we hear disconnects from our local nonprofit leaders that sometimes when they get some new donors on their board or attention from them, it's kind of like, how do we just turn this thing upside down? And sort of a language barrier too. On the fourth bucket that the authors talk about is the new philanthropist, which I think is really wonderful, take a diversified vehicle approach, you know? So you had Sally Osberg from Skoll, right? You know, yes. And the four different approaches that Jeff Skoll has taken, four or five, in terms of how he works for social good. Mm-hmm. All that should be applauded, you know, this is wonderful. But how do you also then address those local needs? So I'm just about gonna wrap up because I think that across all, for all parties that I've talked about, there are barriers on knowledge and information. There's barriers on language and mindset. There are barriers in terms of how our networks overlap or don't overlap. And there's a barrier in terms of just not understanding each other. You know, the authors talk about how a lack of knowledge of the new donors, about how the civil society and the nonprofits in the area actually run and what it means to run one of those, that when you don't have knowledge going back from either direction, you have judgment. That happens, that's sometimes not informed. So I always like to start with, well, what could Packard do better? you know. So I'm really interested to hear your ideas. You know, you've got the Duke Endowment here, you've got Reynolds, you've got a number of large foundations. You know, what should be our response, and how do we work better with our local nonprofit organizations? What is the giving gap? What is the demand and the imbalance between demand and supply? So turning to opportunities, I think there's an opportunity for all of us here. And so someone like Packard Foundation, you know, the way I'm thinking about it is, how do we get better at supporting capacity building for nonprofits? Because it really is true that nonprofits need to up their game. We'll talk about that in a minute. But Packard, actually Dave, while he was still alive, he didn't die till 96, while he was still alive, he started a whole grant-making area of the foundation called Management Assistance, which then became Organizational Effectiveness, run by Barbara Kibbe. But really with the idea that we can't just support these organizations to increase the number of people that they reach, but we have to have them be able to build their capacity, whether it's strategic planning or evaluation or IT infrastructure. And so we started that program. Today we still do it, but how can we get better at it? So for example, we are doing part of something called Propel Next. I know you had Nancy Rube here, but this is from Edna McConnell Clark. They're doing such a great job on capital aggregation and bringing groups together. But something called Propel Next is for those small community-based organizations in a cohort over 9 months, really improving their financial capability, how they talk about their work, how they become more efficient. We have something called the Breakthrough Fund at Stanford, at Packard, where we require a board member and the CEO to come together and participate in a multi-session thing. So there's much more innovation, even just within our foundation, about how we help build capacity of nonprofits to get better. I think we have to look at that reimbursement of how we do our grants. I mean, we make a lot of general support grants, but Packard, like a lot of other large foundations and small foundations, sometimes don't really pay the true cost of an effort when we do a project grant. So there's some great work happening with independent sector hosting it now, and BridgeSpan's involvement about how do we better train our program officers and change how we do work so that we don't have that starvation cycle for our local nonprofits. So I think there's a lot we can do about supporting capacity building. How do we at Packard assist new donors to leapfrog in the learning curves? I mean, we have to know what the new donors want and what relates to them. But you know, we have Silicon Valley 2, social venture partners in Silicon Valley, which are these giving circles. And I think there are 200 active members in those giving circles now that learn about philanthropy together and often go out and visit nonprofits and then get engaged more deeply. Laura Arriaga and Andreessen at Stanford has written a lot on this, and she's starting some things online about how can you have giving circles where donors learn together. How can we support that? Draper Richards Kaplan, I don't know if you've had anyone from there here.
No.
There's so many great things happening in philanthropy, but they have raised, oh man, hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars from donors to basically give early angel kind of investment to nonprofits with good ideas and social entrepreneurs to help build their organization in a sustainable way over a number of years. So there's a lot of creativity going on. How do we use our resources at Packard, the 10 years or 15 years of work on climate or preschool, how do we share that? I tell you, I sometimes really wonder if the juice is worth the squeeze. You know, when we spend a lot of time with a new donor and we share all of this and we have a lot of input, and then I don't know to what extent it translates into new giving. What's a better way to do it? I don't know if any of you have had experience with that, but we're right in the heart of all of this new money. How do we more effectively support groups where we learn together with the new donors and do a better job of marshaling assets? How do we understand each other more? But I think also that the new donors, I hope, you know, also are proactive and show the same kind of initiative that they often have in business to really dig in and learn about the nonprofit sector and reach out, listen, and learn, you know, and have that attitude of learning. And also, this one, I don't know, Joel, if you'd agree with me. There's a big difference. Our work, say, with preschool, that initiative we were talking about, we really were trying to move the needle. And that was strategic philanthropy, as best we could practice it. I do think that at its fundamentals, strategic philanthropy means you have a clearly defined goal, you have a good idea, whether you call it a theory of change or action or whatever, for how your money is going to help reach that goal, how you're going to measure your success, and how you're going to learn while you do it. But that same concept of strategic philanthropy applies also to support for an organization. It's not trying to move the needle, but how do you make that organization, that food bank that serves 1,000 families in a month, be better? What's the goal for them? How do you measure the progress? You can be strategic even in supporting a local community-based organization. And yet I don't hear that often. You know, it's become, rightly so attractive to be going for scale. You know, I said in one of the launch events for this is, you don't do that when you're looking for a quality after school program for your child. You know, you go and you say, hey, how do you run this? What are the impacts on kids? How well do you do with the kids? You don't ask them, how are you changing after school programs in the state of California? You need both. You need both. You need people trying to move the needle. You need trying to go to scale. But you really need to figure out how to support your local organizations. Expanding the networks, you know, you often do live in your bubble. And fundamentally, in all of these, I have about empathy. But what do the new donors need to do? How could we support that? You know, I don't know. Maybe we need to, at Packard, issue challenge grants for new donors or innovation grants that, even though they have the money, sometimes it's really an incentive to say, we'll fund your effort to bring other donors together and you drive it. So I'm almost done here. And so the community-based organizations themselves, though, you know, it's not good enough to look at the numbers and say, gosh, we're just not getting our fair share. You know, so we need, and we have plenty of wonderful nonprofit leaders in the Silicon Valley who are very much stepping up their game in terms of being able to demonstrate their efficiency and their effectiveness in meeting their goals. One of the previous slides talked about the growth in the nonprofit sector. So basically, there's been 30%, 28% growth in the numbers of nonprofits in the last 10 years in those two counties. And so, you know, you really wonder if that's sustainable, and it's part of what I think keeps people from giving locally, is that there are so many organizations and trying to figure out which ones to invest in. A lot of them haven't gotten up to speed in terms of how new donors want to give and learn about organizations, whether it's online or mobile. Anyway, you get the idea that overall, from our perspective, after 53 years at Packard, trying to honor the legacy of our donors and the commitment of our current board to keep a vibrant, important, healthy civil society in our local area at this great time of inequality, that I do believe this report is the beginning of a conversation that we all knew about, that we all need to step up our games, and we all need to figure out how to close this gap. Not to say you shouldn't give locally, but just how can we also direct some of this wealth accumulating to reinvigorate the nonprofit sector in our backyard. So with that, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.